Okay. So today, today is power system operation and control. Presentation on power system operation and control. So presented by R. Sravanti, Department of Electrical and Electronic Engineering, so DBS Institute of Technology. Okay. So why we want to study power system operation and control means? So why you want to study power system operation and control means whenever power will be generating, so the power will be generating, there is a some control, we have to control the power. So the power will be generating, there is no use now, so we have to control the power. So we have to control the power, we have to study this. So whenever we are generating a power, so the fuel cost and incremental cost all are will be increasing, and salary wages also increasing. So the utilization of power will be also increasing. There is no control on power. So whenever we are controlling the power, so we have to minimize the incremental cost, fuel cost, and the salary wages also we have to controlled. So power system operation and control is controlling the economic operation of your system. Okay. So for example, we have taking a thermal power plant. So in thermal power plant, we want to generate a power. So here we have to using some fuel. So you want to control your fuel, then only power will be generated, cost will, the economic generation of cost will be reduced. Okay, so power system operation and control. So first, load curve. So the load curve is a plot of the load demand on y-axis versus a time. So the time period of only 24 hours is considered by resulting a load curve, which is called as daily load curve. So however, the predictable annual requirement of energy occurrence of a load different hours and days in a year in the power supply of economics. Annual load curves also used. So load curve means the curve plotting of the load demand on y-axis and time on x-axis in a chronological order. So we have seeing this. So for we are taking a load curve 24 hours, it is a daily load curve. So whenever you are taking an annual load curve, it is, so when you are taking a load curve for a year, so this is annual load curve. So this is a daily load curve. So when you drawing a graph, load on y-axis and time on x-axis. So this is load, 200, 400, 600, 800,000, 1200 megawatts of load taken on y-axis. So at time will be taken. So time will be at midnight 12 to night 12. Okay. So at this timing, how the load will be varying. So the load curve will tells how the load will be varying from 12 to 12. Okay, so at 4 o'clock, so at 4 o'clock of time, the load will be very less, and 4 to 8, the load will be slowly increasing. At 8 to 4 o'clock, so at 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. the load will be increasing. So the load will be increasing, and after 4, the load will be decreasing. Why the load will be increasing 8 to 4 means, so in 8 to 4, all offices and colleges, schools, and some industries are open from 8 to 4. That's why the high peak load, so high load we are using from 8 to 4. So daily load curve means, so the load curve tells how much load of we are using from time to time will it will tells. Okay, so next, an annual load curve is plot of a load demand of the consumer against a time in hours of year. So when you take annual load for 1 year, so 1 year 8760 hours will be there. So for 1 year 8760 hours are there. Observe the variation of load on a power system during different hours of a day. Area under this curve gives the number of units generated in a day. Highest point of and that curve indicates the maximum demand on the power station on that day. So the area of this curve divided by 24 hours gives average load on a power station in a day. It helps the selection of rating number of generating units required. So in this, so this is we draw a curve for daily load curve. So for we are taking 24 hours load. So whenever maximum load will be occur, this is a maximum demand of load. Okay, so the curve under this area will be up. We have so the curve under this, the curve area in the, so we have choosing, so the curve under this load, this area will called generating units. So generating, consumer generating units. Okay, so and next, load duration curve. So for example, so this load curve will be calculated daily or for a year. So we have calculated for a year, so the hours will be 8760 hours. Okay, and the load duration curve. So the load duration curve is a plot of load demand in units of power arranged in a descending order of magnitude on y-axis and the time hours of on x-axis. The whole load duration curve can be drawn as shown figure. So load duration curve. So the load duration curve is the plot of the load demand arranged in descending order of a magnitude on the y-axis. So the load demand will be arranged in descending order on y-axis and the time taken in x-axis. So we have to see. So this is the load duration curve. So load duration curve. So we have arranged descending order. So we have to take descending order. So 200, 400, 600, 800, 1000, 1200 megawatts. So on here, time of a day in hours. Okay, so load duration curve means here on y-axis we have arranged load in descending order. Okay, so in load duration curve we have integration load duration curve. So the integrated load duration curve is a plot of a cumulative number of units of electrical energy on x-axis and the load demand on y-axis. So the duration curve of particular power station indicated so in this figure. Obviously the area enclosed by the load duration curve represents the daily energy generated in megawatt hour. Okay, so already I tell na, so the curve, the area enclosed by the load duration curve represents the daily energy generated. Okay, so the integrated load duration curve means the load duration curve is a plot of cumulative number of units of electrical energy on x-axis and the load demand on y-axis. So this is a integrated load duration curve. So we have taking load on y-axis and taking time on x-axis. So and this is another figure. So load in megawatts and in y-axis and the energy generated in megawatt hour will be on x-axis. So the minimum load on a station is D megawatt. The energy generated during the 24 hours period is 24 D megawatt hour. So we have taken, so minimum load on a station will be D megawatts and energy generated during a 24 hours period will be 24 D. So the day area of rectangle ODBA, so you have seen figure OD. So ODBA. So the area of rectangle. So this area of rectangle ODBA. So we can assume that the energy generated varies linearly with the load demand from 0 to D1 to D2 megawatt. So indicated, we have seen figure. So the area of rectangle ODBA. We can assume that energy generated varies linearly with the load demand from 0 to D1 to D2 megawatt. So in this area of rectangle, we have to see the load demand will be varies from 0 to D1 to D2. Okay. So, and as the load demand increases, so the energy generated varies linearly with the load demand. So the energy varies linearly with the load demand. So you have to see in this graph. So the load demand linearly varies with the energy generated. So the energy generated will be varying linearly with the load demand. We have seeing in this figure. Okay. So linearly varying means the curve will be like this. Okay. So the load demand increases from D1 to D2 megawatt. The total energy generated will be less than 24 D2 megawatt. Since the load demand of D2 megawatt persists of a duration of less than 24 hours. Okay. So when load will be increasing from D1 to D2, the total energy generated will be less than the 24 D2. Why? Because means the duration is less than 24 hours. So here the load will be load demand increasing from D1 to D2. So the energy generated in this D2 will be very less than of 24 hours of energy will be generating due to, so here the increasing energy load will be less than 24 hours. Okay. So the total energy generated is given by area of OD2 B2 A1. So we have to see in this graph, the total energy generated will be OD2 B2 A1. So this area under this curve will representing the total energy generated area. Okay. So the energy generating between the load demands D1 to D2 is the area of OD2 B2 minus the area of OD1 B1 A1, and that's equal to area of D1 D2 B1. So shown that cross launched in a figure. So now the total number of units generated was plotted as subsequently corresponding to a given load. We shall obtain this, that is called as an integrated load duration curve. So total number of units generated was plotted on the subsequently corresponding to a given load. So we shall obtain that is called integrated load duration curve. So integration load duration curve means so number of units generated will be plotted and will be plotted corresponding to a given load. Okay. So thus if area of OD2 B2 A1 were designed as a C2 megawatt hour, then the point P has a two coordination E2 and D2 on the integrated load duration curve as shown in figure. So the integrated load duration curve is also plot of cumulative integration of area under the load curve starting at zero loads to a particular load. It exhibits the increasing slope up to the peak load. Okay. So you have seeing in graph here, the load will be varying from D1 to D2. Okay. So the load will be varying from D1 to D2. So here from D1, the load will be 0, D1, B1, A1. This is calculated for 24 hours. So on this area will represent energy generated for 24 hours. So when load increasing D2, so the load increasing D2, so the area 0, D2, B2, A1 will be energy generated for energy generated in this load for increasing the load D2. Okay, so when you drawing a graph, so energy generated 24 hours will be for 24 hours energy generated megawatt hours for 24 hours, and the load will be increasing D1 to D2. The curve will be linear, so the curve will be cumulating energy generating. So the load will be linearly varying, we have to see, and it reaches a peak load. So it reaches a peak load. So integrated load duration curve means the curve drawing a load and the so the curve drawing between load versus energy generated. Okay, so next, uses of integrated load duration curve means the amount of energy generated between different load levels can be obtained from the acknowledgement of daily energy requirement, the load that can be carried on the base or peak can be easily determined. So by using integrated load duration curve, so the energy generated between the different load levels can be obtained. So we have to see in graph. So load will be increasing D1 to D2. So the energy generated between D1 to D2 we have calculated. So from the acknowledgement of daily energy requirement, the load that can be carried on the base or peak can be easily determined. So whenever we can calculate the amount of energy generated between two different loads, then we can carry it on the, so the load that can be carried on the base or peak can be easily determined. So for a daily and in how many times we can use base load and peak load can be calculated by using integrated load duration curve. Okay, so next, base load and peak load on a power station. So base load means it is the unvarying load that occurs almost during the whole day on the station. Peak load means it is the various peak demand of a load over the above the base load of a station. Okay, base load means it is unvarying load. Peak load means it is various depending upon the demand of load. Okay, so when load will be more we have to using, then it will be called peak load. So base load means normally in morning time we are not so much of energy will be using, so that is base load. So we have to see in graph. So load in megawatt, time in hours. So this is base load. So at base load there is any not varying, but in peak load, first here it is a peak load, after it will be reaches to base load, and again the load will be increasing. So here it is a peak load, so that means the peak load will be varying, but base load will not varying. Okay, so next, definition of terms and factors. So connected load means to connecting a load for your consumers or customers. So this is connected load. So connected load means a consumer, for example a domestic consumer, may have a several appliances rated as different weightages. So the sum of these rating is or her connected load. Connected load is the sum of ratings, watts, kilowatts or megawatts of the appreciation installed on a consumer precious. So connected load means so by connecting the load, for example we have taking a domestic purpose load. So domestic purpose load, so in morning time we are using, so in morning time from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock we are not using so much of power. After 8 o'clock we have used some amount of energy, and evening 6 o'clock the load will be more we have to use. So That is called connector load. Connector load means to connecting a load to the any consumers. That is called connector load. So we have to take an domestic consumer. So for domestic consumer may have several appliances rated at different weightages. So the sum of these rating so his or her connected load. So connected load is the sum of ratings of watts, kilowatts or megawatt. So in sometime we have using watts of power, and sometime we are using kilowatts of power, or sometimes we are using megawatts of power. So this sum is called connected load. Okay. So maximum demand. So maximum demand means it is the maximum load used by a consumer at any time. It can be less than or equal to the connected load. So maximum demand means when we are using a maximum demand of load, that is called maximum load. It can be sometimes less than connected load or equal to connected load. So if all the device connected to a consumer's house run to their fullest existence simultaneously, then the maximum demand will be equal to the connected load. But generally, the actual maximum demand will be less than the connected load. So the maximum demand is usually measured in kilowatts or megawatts by the maximum demand indicator. Okay, so maximum load means whenever we are using a maximum load on a stay on maximum load for our requirement, it is called maximum demand. Okay, so maximum demand will be calculated in kilowatts or megawatts. Okay, next, demand factor. So the ratio of maximum demand to connected maximum demand to the connected load is called a demand factor. So demand factor equal to maximum demand by connected load. And average load. Average load means if the number of kilowatt hours supplied by a station on one day is divided by a 24 hours, then the value obtained is known as daily average load. So we have calculated daily average load. So how much of energy will be used in 24 hours? So some of the we are using 24 hours load, we have to divide it that 24 hours, then the obtained value will be daily average load. So average load means if the number of kilowatt hours supplied by a station in one day is divided by 24 hours. So next, so we have calculated daily average means kilowatt hour in one day, and monthly average means kilowatt hour one day by 30 into, so for month 30 into 24. Yearly average load means kilowatt hour in one day by 365 into 24. So for a year we have 365 days into 24. So daily average load means per a day how much of energy we are using in so that can be divided by 24 hours. So we have to calculate monthly average load, how much energy will be used for a month, that can be divided by 30 into 24 hours. And yearly average load means how much of energy we are using in per year, that can be divided by 365 into 24. Okay, so and next, load factor. So load factor means the ratio of average demand to the maximum demand is called a load factor. Load factor is equal to average demand by maximum demand. So load factor will be calculated by average demand by maximum demand. And diversity factor. So diversity factor is the ratio of sum of the maximum demand of a group of consumer to the simultaneously maximum demand of a group of consumers. So diversity factor simply we have to say sum of individual maximum demand by maximum demand on a station. So sum of individual maximum demand by maximum demand on a station. So it is called diversity factor. And next, plant capacity. It is the capacity or power for which a plant station is designed. It would be slightly more than the maximum demand. it is equal to sum of ratings of all generators in a power station. Okay, so plant capacity means so which plant, so for example a plant will be designed, plant will be designed 15 kV, so that plant capacity will be 15 kV, you have to say. So that's like, so it is the capacity or power for which plant or station is designed. So it should be slightly more than maximum demand, more than maximum demand, or it is equal to sum of ratings of all generators in a power station. So in a power station, all generators will generate a power. So those sum will be called as plant capacity. And plant capacity factor means it is the ratio of average demand to the average demand on the station to the maximum installed capacity of a station. So plant capacity factor equal to average demand by maximum installed capacity. So plant capacity factor means average demand by maximum installed capacity. Okay. So plant capacity factor is also called as capacity factor. So capacity factor has another formula. So load factor into utilization factor into reverse capacity. Okay. And that is equal to plant capacity minus maximum demand. So plant capacity factor will be calculated for another formula when we plant capacity minus maximum demand. Okay. And next, utilization factor or plant use factor. So utilization factor or plant use factor means it is the ratio of kilowatt hour generated to product the plant capacity and the number of hours which the plant was in operation. So plant use factor equal to station output in kilowatt hour by plant capacity into hours of use. So utilization factor means ratio of kilowatt hour generated to the product of kilowatt hour generated to the product of the plant capacity and the number of hours we have to use in. Okay. So this is the, so station output in kilowatt hour by plant capacity into hours of use. Okay. And next, economic operation of power system. So economic operation of power system. So this economic operation of power system will be in three parts. So economic distribution of loads between the units of plants. Economic distribution of loads between the units of plant and generating limits and economic sharing of loads between the different plants. Okay. So economic distribution of loads between the units of plant. So we have to discussing economic distribution of loads between the units of plants. So economic distribution of loads between the units of plants means to determine the economic distribution. So to determine the economic distribution of load among the different units of plant, the variable operating cost of each unit must be expressed in terms of its power output. The fuel cost is the main cost in thermal or nuclear unit. Then the fuel cost must be expressed in terms of power output. The other costs such as operation and maintenance cost can also be expressed in terms of power output. So fixed costs such as capital cost, description, etc. are not included in the fuel cost. Okay. So economic distribution of loads between the units of plants, man, you have to calculate the economic. So economically we can calculate how much of economics we are using for distribution and operating and maintenance cost. These are all will come in for economic. Okay. So to determine the economic distribution of load among the different units of plants, so the variable cost of each unit must be expressed in terms of power output. The fuel cost and maintenance cost in thermal or nuclear unit must be expressed in terms of power output. So other costs such as operation and maintenance cost can also be expressed in terms of power output. So fixed cost such as capital cost, depreciation, etc. are not included in the fuel cost. Okay. So the fuel requirement of each generator, fuel requirement of each generator is given in terms of rupees per hour. So how much fuel is required for the hour? So we have to calculate it. And let us define the input cost of unit. So for one input, how much cost will be how much cost? Okay. And FI in hours per hour, and the power output of units as PI. So then the input cost can be expressed in terms of power output. So for example, you have taken FI is the power input. So the power input will be expressed in terms of power output. Okay. So this is AI by 2 plus PI square and BI into PI plus C. Okay. So the input power will be expressed in terms of the power output. Okay. So the input power will be calculated in rupees per hour. Okay. So the operation cost is given, the above quadratic equation is obtained approximation of the power in megawatt. So versus the cost in rupees curve. So the incremental operating cost of each unit is then computed. So the incremental cost will be lambda I, that is equal to differentiation of incremental fuel cost with respect to power output. So that we have differentiating this, this input power. So obtained will be AIPI plus BI. Okay. That will be obtained in megawatt hour. So let us now assume that only two units have different incremental costs apply a load. There will be a reduction in cost if some amount of load is transferred from the unit with the higher incremental cost to the unit with lower incremental cost. In this fashion, the load is transferred from the less efficient unit to the more efficient unit, thereby reducing the total operation cost. The load transfer will be continued till the incremental cost of both units are same. This will be optimum point of operation for both the units. So the above principle can be extended to a plant with a total n number of units. So the total fuel cost will be simulation in the fuel of individual. So fuel cost FI. So here I equal to 1 and so on n. So for n number of units, the total input power equal to F1 plus F2 and so on Fn. So that will be, we have to calculate k equal to 1 to n Fk. Okay. So let us denote the total power that the plant is required to supply PT equal to, so that PT equal to total power in one station, second station, up to n stations, the total power will be Pn. So that will be right hand. So sigma k equal to 1 to n Pk. So where P1 and so on Pn are the power supplied by n different units. So the objective is minimizing Ft for a given Pt can be achieved when the total differentiation DFT becomes zero. So this total input will be differentiating with respect to PT and equating zero. So DFT equal to dou F1 by dou P1 into DP1. And next here, dou F2 by dP2 into DP1, DP2, plus and so on, dou FT by dou PN into DPN is equal to zero. Okay. So now since the power supplied assumed to be constant, we have So the power will be supplied will be assumed as constant. So these are equating zero. So multiplying one point. So multiplying this equation with lambda. So dou pt by dou p1 minus lambda into d. Sorry. So in this equation we are subtracting the lambda. Okay. So dou pt by dou p1 minus lambda into dou p1, dou pft by dou p2 minus lambda into dou p2 plus and so on, dou pt by dou pn and minus lambda into dou pn equal to zero. So the equality in this equation is satisfied when each individual term given in the bracket is bracket is zero. This gives us dou pt minus lambda equal to zero and I equal to one and so on n. So we are equating in this bracket will be zero. So next we have to see. Also partial derivative becomes full derivative. Since only the term fi of ft varies with pi and I equal to one. So we have lambda equal to dou f1 by dou p1 and that equal to dou f2 by dou p2 and that is equal to dou f1 by dou p1. Okay. So in this we are calculated lambda. Okay. So this is called economic distribution of loads between the plants. Okay. So next, generation limit. It is not always necessary that all the units of plants are available to share a load. Okay. So not always necessary that all the units of plants are available to share the load. Some of the units may be taken off due to schedule maintenance. Also, it is not necessary that less efficient units are switched off during off peak hours. Okay, there is a certain amount of shutdown and startup cost associated with shutting down unit during the off peak hours and servicing it back on the line during the peak hours. So to complete the problem further, it may take about 8 hours or more to restore the boiler and boiler of unit and synchronizing the unit with the bus. Okay. So next, to meet the sudden change in the power demand. So to meet the sudden change in the power demand, it may differ necessary to keep more units than it is necessary to meet the load demand during that time. So the safety margin in generation is called spinning reverse. So it means whenever we are the load will be shut down. So when load will be shut down, and suddenly we have required the power demand. So we have required power demand. It may necessary to keep more units than it is necessary to meet the load demand during that time. The safety margin generation is called spinning reverse. So the spinning reverse means whenever the load will not working when the load will be shut down at some time we have requiring the power demand. Okay, so we have requiring power demand. So whenever we switch on the power station, so then it is necessary to meet the load demand during that time. So this is safety margin generation. So this is called spinning reverse. So optimal load dispatch problem must be then incorporate the startup and shutdown cost. Further, without endangering of the system security. Okay, the power generation limit of each unit, the power generation of generation limit of each unit then given by the inequality constraints. Okay, so P minimum is less than or equal to Pi and less than or equal to P max. Here I equal to 1 to n. Okay, So the maximum limit of PG max is the upper limit of power station capacity of each unit. On the other hand, the lower limit PG minimum is certain to the thermal consideration of operating boiler in thermal or nuclear generating station. An operational unit must produce minimum amount of power such that boiler thermal components are stabilized to minimum designing operation temperature. Okay. So this is our topic. Okay.